and then comply with the formalities. According to this point, you have to have a good faith requirement to do that. So if you are present in that meeting, it may be helpful for you to remember this and say, hey, wait a minute, what about good faith? Of course, the next question may be, would you like to keep your job? but this is a different story. So, applicable situations, no entry, unliquidated consumption, and good faith of prohibited merchandise. Let's look at the how customs examiners test you on this. Which of the following items may not be directly exported? And here is the situation I just talked about. The correct answer is you cannot directly export the merchandise which was known by the importer to be prohibited at the time of entry. Importer knows that they bring in bacterial soap, antibacterial soap, which is regarded as a drug. It has drug facts, and they have no, they did not go through the formalities with Food and Drug Administration, which regulates drugs. Okay, next one. Required documents for the direct exportation. Recall, four copies of, recall, there's this rule of four, right? Four copies of CBP Form 7512. Four copies. Extra copy may be required. Bond required. And remember that question we talked about? It's right over here. It's part of the outline, actually. The admission of the United States to the, for the shipment into the United States is prohibited. And what's the option? And the importer has the option to file for direct exportation instead of entry for consumption. What's required? Four copies of 7512. And CB Form 301. So we saw that already, but it's worth emphasizing that the formalities are important. Paying attention to the formalities can pay off on the exam. Export declaration. So this is a whole different animal because export declaration is really not part of the customs broker exam. It just barely attaches it, but pretty much you have to declare that you export something every time you're going to export something out. And that declaration is done usually electronically through the EEI, Electronic Export Submission System, something like that. And you get some kind of number. And with that number is, once you file it, you get the number back. And with that number, you can go to the carrier, and that carrier has a green light to ship it out, pretty much. And the declaration has to be done electronically. It has to be done to the, not to customs, but to census. And the declaration will include things such as Schedule B numbers, which is almost the counterpart of HTS-US. So classification is also required for export, believe it or not. And licensing information, if necessary. And information such as shipper name, local party name, etc., etc. So declarations required for merchandise landed, not entered to consumption. It came in, it did not come out yet. It is about to come out. Merchandise transferred from one vessel to another. So you have a feeder vessel and a mother vessel. One vessel comes into New York, it goes from vessel one to vessel two, and then it goes back to Jamaica, or goes to Jamaica, let's say. Merchandise is entered for consumption and rejected. You brought in 7501, and you got a reject, you're upset, you say, okay, no more, I don't want to deal with the United States, I'm taking it out of the country. You have to declare export declaration. You have to do the export formalities too. So what's this situation, what does it not cover? So when would the export declaration would not be required? It covers pretty much almost every situation, right? So why do you have this list of three? What would not be included? How about the stuff that comes on a ship and never gets off the ship? You have a container that, you have a ship that stops, goes to Miami, and then it goes to Venezuela. So Miami is in the United States, and then Venezuela is in the south of the United States, right? The container destined to Venezuela stops in Miami port, but it never gets off the ship, right? It just stays on the ship. Never touches land, right? It's not entered to consumption. It's not transferred from the vessel. It stays on the same vessel because the next port call will be in Venezuela. For that type of situation, you do not need to file the export declaration.
Yeah.
So export. So the question is this: do you need to be a licensed customs broker to file the export declaration? No. You need to have a power of attorney, and you need to have a system, the EEI, access to EEI system, and let's see, AES. I'm sorry, automated export system, AES. And EEI stands for Electronic Export Information. So to get access to EES, you have to complete some kind of seminar. I think it's done online. And you have to pass some kind of questionnaire, question and answer, like there's a little test. And once you get approved, you can file entries. I'm sorry, you can file declarations for export. Customs brokers do that. No license is required. Power of attorney is a must. So you must have power of attorney because you are an agent. You do not need to be licensed. So any of us can do this. The primary responsible party for doing this is called USPPI, United States Principal Party of Interest. So it's just another label for the party. If something is export, let's say I'm exporting, let's say rifle scopes, right? So I have, let's say this is a rifle scope, right? And I have a, it's a laser rifle scope. So it is subject to what? It is subject to controls, right? Let's say it's a military rifle scope, one that is used by special forces. Wow, it's on the munitions list. And it's being exported to where? Let's say this goes to Russia. Wow. So it's a subject to controls. You need a license from the Department of State. And you don't use a license for the Department of State. You just ask for without a license. Who is liable? Who is going to jail? Who is paying penalties? USPPI, United States Principal Party of Interest. So in other words, USPPI is the same, has the same connotation as importer of record. It's a term of art because we have very, USPPI can be also foreign party of interest, right? But it's more complicated, but again, there are labels and terms. The point is you need to have someone who is responsible, who will claim responsibility for the shipment. And if it's not an agent, it must be US principal party of interest. Agents usually try to move, stay away, because they do not know what's inside. Yeah, you tell them this box is a box of chocolates. But how do you know if it's possible? You don't know, go through this box. You didn't pack it. So you're just merely facilitating the shipment. So gunpowder, can be exported, but it can be subject to the restrictions such as direct exportation only. So this completes our discussion on merchandise in transit. Merchandise in transit, the part 18, usually shows up here and there. There are several questions. It's not the huge heavy hitter on a customs broker exam, but it it's worth preparing for it, because it shows consistently. One or two questions show up consistently. There may be more questions embedded, so you have a pattern question where you have date of entry, immediate transportation, how much duties you pay, you have to figure out the harmonized tariff schedule, and you have to know the entry date. And if it's under immediate transportation, you really need to figure out the whole chain of events. So this part by itself doesn't weigh that much, but in a whole scheme of things, it really fills in the void, which can give one a general understanding of the events that take place.